All right, guys, the moment you've been waiting for. He's well known for his work on Silver Surfer and Green Lantern, as well as the Marvel vs. DC crossover Batman vs. Aliens. He's also worked on the CrossGen Comics series Scion, Mystic, Sojourn, and The Path. And Dark Horse Comics, he created Samurai, Heaven and Earth, and various Star Wars comics. His current creator-owned projects include Dragon Prince from Top Cow, Samurai and Heaven Earth from Dark Horse, and especially for fans in Hyderabad, we present an exclusive session with him. Ladies and gentlemen, a big round of applause for Ron Marz! Come on, Hyderabad, I can't hear you guys. And joining him for the session will be none other than RPG's Keeney!
Oh, so we both get one? That's pretty good.
Are you lucky me?
I have the red one, you have the purple one.
That's my favorite color.
Hey, thanks for coming, everybody.
So, are we all set? Pretty much? I can't hear you.
Yeah!
First, how's Hyderabad treating you?
Great. I don't want to go home. Can I come stay with one of you guys? I won't take up a lot of space.
You evidently have a lot of fans out here, and not just in Hyderabad, I think all over India. So I think Hyderabad is one lucky city to have you over. How does it feel?
When we got in, it felt like I was jet lagged, is how it felt. But this has been an awesome trip. I couldn't be happier with all you guys that came out. This is a lot cooler than an American show. I mean, American shows are kind of the same show with the same people and the same stuff for sale in a different cement bunker in a different city every weekend. This is a lot cooler. This is a lot more fun.
Those are more points for Hyderabad. These one round of applause for this, please. All right, so let's get down to this list, this huge list of comics you have given us. Of course, Vijay read out some of those. My personal favorites: Silver Surfer, Green Lantern, Witchblade. A lot of fans for this brand. And Marvel vs. DC. I mean, this is one huge list. How did it all begin? I mean, what made you take up what you started doing?
I was actually a journalist. That was great, right? I was actually a journalist before I started writing comics. Do it a little further. Is that better? Is that better? So I was a journalist before I started writing comics. And I had friends who were making their living doing comics, either as writers or artists, and they kind of led me into the business 25 years ago, and I've been doing it ever since. I haven't wanted for work a day in that time. Thank God. It's because I don't want to go get a real job. I would prefer to just keep making up stuff. So as long as you guys keep buying it, I don't have to get a real job.
Okay, so your work with Marvel's Silver Surfer has been...
There's stuff back
there. Oh yeah, there's going to be stuff on loop. So as we cover different titles, we'll have those little images come up. Silver Surfer was a great stint of yours back in the day with Marvel. But let me come to one milestone of an event that you created back in the 90s with Emerald Twilight for Green Lantern. I mean... It's one of my personal favorites, and I told you I'm going to be fanboying you about this. So, Green Lantern had always been in that particular, phase where you knew the kind of storylines that were coming. And suddenly, there was the Emerald Twilight, where Hal Jordan goes ballistic and, you know, things just changed totally for the entire canon. Talk to us about the experience of how this, you know, Emerald Twilight idea came together.
Emerald Twilight was a really kind of an editorially driven story in that, I don't get to come in and decide that Hal Jordan goes crazy and then we create a new Green Lantern. That comes from on high at DC Comics. They decided that they wanted to do that, kind of following up on the death of Superman and Batman getting his back broken. Those were obviously two big stories. They decided they wanted to do something with Green Lantern because sales on the Green Lantern book weren't great. Might be shocking to find out that comic book publishers actually like to sell a lot of comics, so they're concerned with what the sales are like. So they called me kind of late one night on a Thursday, I think. I had just been in the Marvel offices all day talking about Thor. I got home. My wife and I, who is out there somewhere, my wife and I went out for pizza, and when we got back, DC Comics called about 9 o'clock at night and said, do you want to take over Green Lantern? But, wow, this is going to be kind of cool, because, you know, Hal Jordan's a cool character, and he's got a great costume. And then they said, yeah, well, here's actually what we want you to do. So so I got my marching orders of just the basics of what Emerald Twilight was going to be about. And it took me about 2 weeks to decide if I wanted to do it, because I knew it was going to be a fairly big deal story. It was obviously going to be fairly controversial, too. So after about 2 weeks, they needed an answer, so I decided that I would do it. It was my first regular DC gig, because I had mostly been working for Marvel at that point. And once I decided that I was going to be in and do it, I had to write all three issues of Emerald Twilight at basically the same time. So we had three different artists on three different issues, because the issues were incredibly late on deadline. So I wrote 5 pages of issue 48, 5 pages of issue 49, and 5 pages of issue 50 to get everybody working. And then I had to go back and finish 48, and after that finish 49, and after that finish 50, all in the space of about 2 weeks, I guess. So I remember writing some of that on the train in New York. I remember writing some of it in the balcony at a Peter Gabriel concert. So, like, any extra time I had was devoted to those three issues. And, you know, I'm still pretty happy with the way they came out. I would have liked to have had maybe 6 issues to tell that story, but they wanted it to be over with by issue 50 so that they could start new with issue 51. So we kind of squeezed what probably should have been about 6 issues worth of story into 3 issues.
And, you know, amidst all this, you gave us 2 very important characters in the whole Green Lantern canon, Parallax and Kyle Rayner. So, I mean, Kyle Rayner was a radically different Green Lantern from what we had seen before. I mean, there was Hal Jordan already, then there was the Guy Gardner, you know, template of this rebel sort of a character. But then there was Kyle Rayner, you know. Was it like a conscious effort to make him, you know, one of those creative cartoonist guys who just, you know, take things, like the willpower things he creates, those formations he creates are completely hilarious sometimes. I mean, this is something I hadn't seen before in a Green Lantern storyline.
Well, the DC gave me a fairly wide range of what I could do with the new character. They were, you know, they gave me instructions on what they wanted Emerald Twilight to be, in, you know, about a page and a half of notes. And the last line in the notes was, and a new Green Lantern is introduced. Beyond that, they didn't really tell me what to make a new character. I asked if we could have the main character be a woman. They said they would prefer that the book stayed a male lead and somebody from Earth rather than an alien. We were kind of on our own after that, and they just let us do what we wanted to do. So I didn't see any reason to do a character that was going to be a version of Hal Jordan Light. I mean, if we were going to do a different character than Hal, he should be as different from Hal as possible. So, you know, to me, Hal was a hero already. He was a test pilot. He was sort of the, you know, typical DC square-jawed hero. So he was a hero before he ever got the ring. So I wanted to do somebody who was more like all of us. And when I was a kid, I read a lot of Spider-Man comics. So I loved the fact that Peter Parker was just as interesting out of costume as he was in the Spider-Man costume. So that's what I wanted to bring to Kyle. I wanted that everyman type of character. There's apparently a parade going on. I wanted this character to be somebody that was very relatable for the audience. That would be like me or you getting the power ring. What would you do with it? And I wanted it to be somebody who had to grow into the role of being a hero, because a lot of times the hero's journey of becoming a hero is a lot more interesting than the guy who is already a hero.
That's a great point.
So the short version of that answer is, I ripped off Spider-Man.
We probably won't take that version from you. But, you know, there was this little anecdote I read in one of your interviews in the past, is that you got some serious threats and protests after, you know, whatever happened in the Emerald Twilight. Does that happen? I mean, do angry fans actually threaten writer?
Oh, yeah. You know, it's actually a lot worse now because of social media and the instantaneous nature. You know, if somebody gets pissed off about something that you write, I mean, they can give you feedback as soon as they put the book down. You know, back before there was a lot of social media, you actually had to stay pissed long enough to write a letter, put it in an envelope, put a stamp on the envelope, and send it off to DC Comics. So, I think it's actually kind of worse now, but we did get, you know, we did get a number of kind of threatening letters that, you know, that either wanted me fired. We got a lot of those. That either wanted me fired or a few of them that wanted me dead. So yeah, there were a few that were like actual death threats that DC handed over to the New York Police Department, because that's what you have to do when you get death threats, even the ones that are in crayon. And there was actually one in crayon. We didn't take that one real seriously. But, you know, it was kind of a lesson for me in... This was the first time I had, you know... Having written Silver Surfer and Thor, those fandoms were loyal, but Green Lantern has a really fanatical fandom. And I didn't really know that going into the whole game. I mean, I think the only fandom that's even more crazed is, like, Legion of Superheroes. Because those people are hardcore. The Green Lantern fans, I maybe are just a notch below that. So the fact that we did something that was pretty permanent at the time really set off a lot of people. But I kind of felt like it was good. I mean, if we had done a story that pleased everybody, to me that probably means it was kind of a boring story. So we didn't set out to get people angry, but we knew it was going to happen. There obviously were readers who were very attached to Hal Jordan and didn't want anything to change. This might come as a shock, but comic fans are not real good at accepting change. You know, and then if you change something, they're pissed off. If you don't change anything, they write you and tell you, this is the same stuff all the time, why don't you change something? So you know, it was an education for me in that. The fans, you can't please everybody, so your primary audience has to be yourself.
They don't cut you any slack, do they?
You know, you want a reaction out of the audience. Yeah. You don't want to provoke somebody just for provoking them, but you want the audience to be emotionally invested in the story.
Reactions are healthy then, right? I mean, you have to have some reaction to any artistic work, be it, you know, writing, music, anything. There has to be a reaction. It can't just be a neutral piece of art. I think the Emerald Twilight did what it had to do. But, you know, since you've mentioned social media right now, we do know that, you know, nowadays the world is a smaller place. Writers, artists, you know, actors kind of get to interact with their fans quite regularly. As a writer, for you, how much does a fan reaction kind of influence the way you would kind of take a story arc further? If you think that someone is, you know, the fans feel like, you know, the character has to be in a particular, you know, mode, or something has to be done to it, does that influence your thinking, or, you know, you want to do what you have to and kind of let them react to it?
It doesn't influence me at all. And I know that, like, there are writers who want to court the audience's affection, But I think that, you know, at that point, you're kind of a trained monkey dancing for change. I've never, you know, this sounds awful to say, and I appreciate every one of you reading the stuff, but I don't write it for you, I write it for me. So I write the story that I want to read. I write the story that I think will entertain me the most, and then I hope you guys come along for the ride. I'm the only audience whose tastes I know and I'm sure of. So I do the best job to entertain myself, and I keep my fingers crossed that everybody else is entertained.
Moving on.
So another short answer is I don't really care what you want.
Moving on. Here in India, for decades, when one speaks of superheroes and comics, a generic name was Phantom and Mandrake, and all these old comics that have been such treasures today that collectors go crazy when they see these old issues out there somewhere. So you've done. You've worked on the Phantom Prose series for Moonstone, right? How was it, kind of working with a character which is like a nostalgic feel? I'm sure it had to. It's not yet in the current time frame. It's still in the nostalgic mode, is it?
I love a lot of the pulp characters, and really Superman and Batman are pulp characters too. They date from that period, and they're very much of those characters, like The Shadow, like Doc Savage, and I've always really liked the Phantom. Even though like a guy in the jungle with a purple costume doesn't make a whole lot of sense, but I always thought it was kind of cool. I had some early Charlton Phantom comics when I was a kid that I always thought were great. So, one of the great things about my job is that I get to scratch certain itches that I have for characters, stuff that I want to write, and that's how the Moonstone thing came about, is because I wanted to write a Phantom story. So I got a hold of them and said, look, I will do, I'll do a Phantom story for your, for your really lousy page rates that you pay for this stuff, just because I wanted to do it. And then I roped a bunch of my friends into, writing and drawing other chapters of it. So I got to, tell my Phantom story. I've got a number of other things like that, Tarzan and John Carter and things like that that I grew up with and I grew up loving. And, one of the cool things is that you get to touch those touchstones from your childhood. And that's exactly what the Phantom was. I would love to do another Phantom story at some point.
We all love Phantom.
is Phantom still published here?
It's only in the recent times that we've seen the new imprints. It had been in limbo for a long time. And that left a lot of collectors a little sad that something like that is still, not available in the market. But it's only recently that we've been seeing some imprints, and we're just happy. It used to run in the newspapers every single day. We used to cut those and keep them and paste them in paper sheets.
You keep them in books?
Yeah. So, yeah, we have a crazy comic culture out here. So, looking at the kind of titles and characters you've worked on, as a reader as well as an artist myself, I've always thought and wondered, as a writer, I'm sure it is difficult. It's a challenge, I'm sure, when you kind of deal with various universes across. Each character has his own universe. And the kind of complex storylines that you create within each universe is going to be a challenge when you jump from one to another. I'm sure it's a challenge, right?
It just goes along with the job. It's just part of what you signed up for when you took on the job. And I try not to be too beholden to the history or continuity of your character, because if all you're doing is touching points of continuity, touching universal stories that happened 20 years ago, you're not creating anything new, and you're not really telling your own stories. You're just recycling somebody else's stories. So. The Marvel and DC universes are great playgrounds, and there are all the characters and all the toys you could ever want to play with, but one of the reasons that those universes are so great is that people have created stuff all along for them. So you try to strike a balance between using the toys that are there and maybe bringing something new to it as well. It's really the same for like Star Wars stuff that I've written Star Wars comics as well. And I've had people ask me, you know, if it was difficult to make the transition from superheroes to the complex continuity of the Star Wars universe. And it's really the same thing. You have a sandbox to play in, and you know there are rules that you can't break. You can't decide that Darth Vader isn't really Luke's father. Darth Vader's Luke's father. Spoiler. So writing Star Wars stuff was really no different than writing Marvel or DC stuff. It's just a different play box, a different sandbox that you're playing in.
This would bring me directly to Witchblade with Image Comics. When you took over, you changed the entire, the perception towards Witchblade, the kind of storylines it had, the kind of audience perception it had. You changed the entire thing, and then there was a gap. And then you took over again last year. Talk to us about the entire journey of Witchblade, because I think one of your most talked about series is Witchblade and the kind of work you've done for it. So I think, first of all, big round of applause for Witchblade and Ron Marz. Seriously, I mean, I'm sure there has to be some sort of, journey within Witchblade that you had to kind of experience.
Well, when I left CrossGen Comics in 2003, maybe, I needed a job. I walked out of CrossGen Comics because I wasn't happy with the offer that they made me to stay. So I said thanks, but no thanks. And when I got home that night, Dark Horse had heard that there was trouble at CrossGen and called to offer me Star Wars work. And then, the next day, Top Cow called and said, "What do you want to do?" And I ended up doing like a 4-issue Darkness series, and then. After that, well, what do you want to do next? And I said, well, really, Magdalene is my favorite character. It's got great history. It's a great costume. And they said, yeah, that sounds really great. Why don't you do Witchblade? Apparently I didn't have a choice. They only wanted me to think I had a choice. So at that point, I had never actually read a Witchblade comic because my perception of Witchblade was the same thing as everybody else, which was there weren't stories so much as they were excuses for her clothes to fall off. If you want to see that stuff, go to the internet. You don't have to buy comics for that. But I was willing to give it a try because I liked the people at Top Cow and they had treated me well. So I said, look, if you want stories that continue to be excuses for her clothes to fall off, you should get somebody else to do it because that's not what I'm interested in. But if you will let me tell character-driven stories that kind of bring some more dimension to her character and that is more like a police procedural meets X-Files, I'd be interested in doing that. And actually, that's getting those kind of jobs where you're coming in to rehabilitate a book are often the most fun because the bar is set pretty low, so you can't really fail. Now, if my Witchblade stories were lousy, they'd even probably be a little less lousy than the previous ones. But you can come in and change what's been going on in the book because you want to reclaim the project, you want to make it better. So Top Cow said, just tell the stories you want to tell. We support you in wanting to take that direction. Do what you're going to do. And that was really the last time we had the discussion about, if this was going to be kind of a TNA book and, how much sex appeal there was going to be to it, because the subject never came up again, and they let me change the book, and they let me flesh out her character as I wanted to, and I'm still hugely appreciative that they gave me the chance to really do my version of that book, and I think I've actually probably written more issues of Witchblade now than anything else I've worked on. plus it's kind of cool to write a female character, you know, because I like females. I married one, so and I generally think, you know, like, women are smarter than men, and, you know, like, more emotionally together, so that's more interesting to write for me.
As much fun as it is to draw a woman, probably.
I can't draw, so I don't know.
Okay. And then there was a gap, and then you took over last year again, right? Any changes you saw in that gap that you had to kind of rework on and, you know, come back on track, or do you think it was going fine?
Well, when I left the book, it was because my schedule was fairly packed. Top Cow got the offer to do Voodoo for the New 52. Top Cow wanted me to stay on Artifacts, which was originally going to be a 13-issue series, and they decided that it had sold well enough that they wanted to just keep it going. So I stayed on that, left Witchblade, and Tim Seeley came in and took over, did his version of Witchblade, which is perfectly valid. It was different than mine, but he told the stories that he wanted to tell, just like I got to tell the stories that I wanted to tell. And I'm glad that it was a different take, because, you know, if I had just come in and imitated what had gone before, or if Tim had come in and imitated what I had done, it's not giving the audience the true stories that you're passionate about. So Tim came in and did his thing, which was a bit of a throwback to the early days of Witchblade, which is when he was a kid and read those issues, so that's what really inspired him. And then, you know, they asked me to come back and you know, kind of take the book in a different direction again. And I'm having a ball doing it, and I'm working with an Italian woman named Laura Braga, drawing the book, who was phenomenal. I actually got connected with her on Twitter. I saw her work there, and she had done a Witchblade pinup or something like that I saw. And, you know, I found her work. I reached out to her and said we should do something together sometime. So when the Witchblade opportunity came up, I really pushed her to onto Top Cow, and they thankfully said, okay, let's bring her onto the book as the regular artist.
Let's come to the actual process of how you go about your writing. I mean, right from ideation to the way, you know, you kind of structure your story. And let's talk about the way, you know, you kind of work with your artists. Because I'm sure there's some way the writer influences the artist, or the artist influences the writer, or none of the above. Talk to us about this process.
To me, the coolest thing about my job is that ideas that are in my head go down on paper, they get sent to an artist, and then that artist makes them real. The best part of my job 25 years ago when I started doing this is the best part of my job now, which is when the art starts to come into my inbox and I get to see what the artist has done with the story. I can't draw to save my life. I am probably the worst artist in this building, maybe in this country. So I have no ability. I love art. I love all kinds of art, but I have no ability to do it myself. So I have the perfect job in that I get to come up with these stories. I can see the pictures in my head, and then somebody that's vastly more talented than I am gets to bring them to life. So I feel like the real crux of any comic is that the writer-artist relationship. And I certainly write scripts differently for different artists. I try to tailor the scripts to the artist's strengths and stay away from the weaknesses, if there are any. I try to make sure that I'm giving the artist something exciting and interesting to draw on the page every time, because it takes me about a week to write a script. It takes the artist 4 or 5 or 6 weeks to draw that script. They have to live with it every day, so I should give them something that brings them to the board and gets them excited every day. I try to, you know, be in touch with my artist as much as possible, whether it's on email or Skype or instant messages. You know, I talk to my artists more than I talk to my neighbor. I actually don't like my neighbor very much, but he is living in the house next to us. So, but you know, I I talked to Abhishek Malsuni, who's right there, more than I talked to my neighbor. I talked to Stie Ponsejic, that I do Ravine with and did Witchblade with for years, who lives in Croatia, much more than I talk to most people that I see. So it's to me, it's important to have an open line of communication with your artist, and there should be a lot of give and take with the artist too, in terms of, you know, what do you want to draw, what do you not want to draw, do you have ideas that you want into the story. It's a two-way street, and you know, I'm also not dumb enough to that I don't realize if the artist does a great job, I look like a great writer. I can write a mediocre script or even a lousy script, and if a great artist gets a hold of it, at the end of the day, we've got a great story. If I write a brilliant script somehow, and it's given to a lousy artist, we have a lousy story at the end of the day, no matter what.
Any favorite artists you've worked with so far that you want to hear? I mean, I'm sure there have been quite a few, and we are getting to John Carter of Marz.
You mean like any that are standing in the building right now? I'm really blessed that I've been able to work with so many artists. You know, my wish list of guys that I want to do a story with is pretty short at this point. You know, I've been able to work with Jim Starlin and Bernie Wrightson, and Walter Simonson has drawn one of my stories. So those are still the fanboy moments when you get to work with guys who are not only your friends but also your heroes, and they bring their artistry to what you've done. So, you know, if I'm working with an artist long term, they're obviously somebody I'm really happy with. If I work with somebody, you know, once and you never see him again, there were probably issues that you don't know about.
One of the conflicts that any comic fan would face, and I'm sure many of you would agree here with me, is that it's pretty difficult sometimes to nosedive into a series which has been running for, you know, years together. So you get a feeling sometimes that the writing or the whole the tone of the comic, the theme of the comic, probably doesn't care about new readers than it cares about the existing audience. So as a writer, is there a conscious effort to kind of cater to both, like an existing audience as well as a new set of people who are going to come in, so that it's easy for people to start reading a new series right from the middle and not kind of, you know, get confused what happened in the past?
I think that's hugely important in terms of my job, is to make sure that there are entry points for new readers. You know, I think new readers are frankly more important than the existing readers, because the existing readers, we've already got you guys, right? The harsh reality is we're getting your money every month anyway. So obviously we want to keep you happy, but we would like there to be more of you. So any series that I work on, I try to make sure that there are logical points of entry, and that background information, the kind of stuff that you need to know, is worked into the story as often as possible. And, you know, and you don't want it to be as didactic as, Peter Parker, who was bitten by a radioactive spider and now must, with his great power must come great responsibility. You know, that sort of stuff that you see in, you know, you see in Chris Claremont books where there's these huge blocks of text. That's kind of obviously become passé in modern comics. But you also don't want to go to the extent of, and I see this in Marvel and DC books with too much frequency, that the characters aren't even named. Like the author just assumes that you know everything. So they don't even bother to, like, if you look at my stuff, hopefully every character that comes into a scene is named at some point so that you know who the hell they are. But that, you know, even that much background information is sometimes missing. So to me, the issue is balancing the needs of the current story you're telling, but making sure that you find some way to work in everything that the reader needs to know to be comfortable with it, because the worst thing that happens, that can happen, is you get a new reader into a book, somehow we get the hook in your mouth and you want to check out a book, and at the end of the first issue you go, well, I don't have any idea what I just read, I don't know who these people are, why should I should care about them. That's a huge lost opportunity to bring in new readers.
Because when, you know, DC did the new 52, I think that's what they were trying. They wanted to reboot the entire thing. I mean, frankly, I wasn't following, the DC titles as much. But when the new 52 came up, I said, you know, let me just give it a shot and start reading it. But I got confused royally, even if they're doing that. So, which brought me to that question of mine that, you know, it's pretty confusing for readers sometimes. And I think, the titles that you have, I don't think there should be issues like these, but sometimes there's this confusing little aspect with where do I start, you know? So
that's kind of the danger of a shared universe, is these stories have gone on and on and on for so long, the characters have been around so long, and so many people have worked on them, that you start to accumulate barnacles on the hull of a ship the longer you go. And something like New 52, which is supposed to scrape all the barnacles clean, I think that kind of stuff's a good idea. I mean, obviously it all comes down to execution as well, and some books were executed better than others, and some books should have just been executed. It's about striking that balance, but I always prefer to err on the side of, let me tell you what you need to know.
So, closer to home, closer to India, you've been associated with the Indian, comic literature for a while now, with Devi, Sadhu, and projects with Deepak Chopra. Tell us about that. I mean, it's not like you didn't know what's happening on this side of the world, but this is the first time you came here.
Yeah, this is, in some ways, it's not a homecoming, but I feel like I've been able to come full circle a little bit to finally come here and be more immersed in the culture, meet some of the artists that I worked with. Virgin Comics reached out to me, I guess a number of years ago at New York Comic Con. I had been doing a signing, and I went off to have a meeting or something, and when I got back, somebody said, hey, this guy named Gotham Chopra was here looking for you. It's like, what? And eventually, Gotham found me, and he was apparently a fan of my stuff at CrossGen, and told me what was going on with Virgin Comics. The whole relationship sort of evolved from that. They asked me to come in and edit 3 or 4 titles and do some writing as well. So I got to immerse myself in Indian storytelling and Indian mythology to certainly not be the keeper of the lore in terms of the mythology, but to maybe be kind of a storytelling backstop for a lot of the writers and exert some artistic influence on the storytelling for the artists. For as long as Virgin lasted, and now I know it's become Liquid Comics, so that material is still out there and they're still doing some stuff. I felt like I was getting paid to, read a bunch of really cool Indian literature and educate myself in that. And I had a ball doing it. I was sorry to see it end. And I was really proud of a lot of the comics we did. I thought the talent I was working with was almost uniformly terrific. The production on the books was really good. And particularly artistically, I ended up working with some really amazing artists, Jeevan Kang, Mukesh Singh, those guys I'm still in awe of and still would like to work with as a writer.
And speaking of Indian artists, Abhishek Malsuni and you, big round of applause.
Hand up in the air.
Wave out, Abhishek. There he is. You guys have worked on John Carter of Mars, Warlord of Mars, right? John Carter, Warlord of Mars. Uh, you And I've read this, you know, over and over at many interviews of yours. You're really looking forward to this one because I think you guys have...
This one's still good? Yeah. He broke his, apparently.
Check. The purple one didn't like... Can you hear me? The mic couldn't take it. So, you've given it your best. I mean, the promos look awesome. And the art as well as, I mean, you've done a lot behind the whole retelling of the John Carter story. Tell us about how it came about.
I think that better? Yeah. We'll just switch back and forth. So I read the John Carter novels by Edgar Rice Burroughs when, you know, at that magic age of like 11 or 12 years old, when the stuff you discover at that age is the coolest thing ever and it sticks with you the rest of your life. Like, you know, like guys who are a generation younger than me still love Ninja Turtles and Transformers, but, you know, I don't care about that stuff. Because I was one, you know, like, by the time Ninja Turtles and Transformers came around, I was, like, chasing girls. So I wasn't interested in that stuff. So I look at that stuff and go, well, that's kid stuff. That's silly. You know, but the stuff that I was doing at 12 years old, well, that's the best thing ever. So I discovered the John Carter books at just the right age for them to make a huge impression on me. And really for those stories to be one of the reasons that I wanted to become a writer. So I've always wanted to do John Carter comics. Generally, they haven't been done since Marvel did the initial comics in the 70s, or their initial run in the 70s. And when Dynamite got, when Dynamite started publishing John Carter and Tarzan comics, and didn't ask me to do them, I was really pissed. And I told them I was really pissed. So that stuck in Nick Barucci of Dynamite's head, and when they decided to relaunch the books, they came to me and said, "Okay, we're gonna do these again. Do you want to be the guy? Do you want to write them?" And obviously, I said yes immediately. I probably should have held out and negotiated for a better page rate, but you do the things you love for cheap, frankly. So we actually started working on it last October or November, I think, and it's the first issue that Abhishek and I are doing will be out first week in November in the States. Should be out digitally as well, so you guys can pay your $2 or whatever it is and download them. So I'm finally getting to, you know, I'm finally getting to tell John Carter stories, and I finally get to, you know, sort of date the first love of my life, Deja Thoris. And when Dynamite made me the offer to do the book, I knew who I wanted to draw it because we had worked together on a project before. I was as an editor, I worked with Abhishek on stuff for Robolt Entertainment. And I was just hugely impressed by his stuff and the exotic nature of that story. I thought was a really good indicator that he would just do great work on John Carter, and that's not one of his drawings right now. So, but you've seen the John Carter stuff cycling behind us. The book looks amazing. I couldn't be happier with it, mostly because of his talents. He's bringing the stuff that's in my head to life far better than most could, and I'm thrilled to be working with him. And I think he's going to be stuck with me for a while on this book. We're not going to let him go.
That is so cool. And before we end up... Hello? Check. Before we can take a few questions from the audience, any words for budding artists and writers and comic creators in the crowd?
So, how many prospective writers here?
A few.
I'm not telling you guys anything because I don't want you taking my job. Okay? Look, if you want to be a writer, you have to write every day. You have to read every day. The only way you can become a better writer is to write every day, work through all the crappy writing that you have in your system until you finally get to the better stuff. It's really the same way for artists. You have to practice every day. You'll get better every day. You get better at doing comics by doing comics. There's really no... I mean, mostly, the nice thing about a writer is you convince yourself that you can do, that you can add more projects to your plate all the time. Because an artist can basically do one book a month. As a writer, we go, well, I can squeeze that in. I'll find a way, you know. And surely I will be in trouble when I get home with my editors from this trip, because I owe them work, including one I forgot to tell. And he saw my tweet from signing over there. He's like, wait, you're where? So I had to tell him, I'll be back in a few days. So I've never really regretted turning down a project, because if I feel like if you're on the fence about it, go for it.
So, what's your next crossover?
Actually, you know what? I do have one that I regretted turning down.
Yeah, please.
Wildstorm offered Gen 13 to me.
Yeah.
And I didn't really want to write about teenagers. So I said, I'll do Stormwatch instead. And then, you know, and then Gen 13 came out with J. Scott Campbell drawing it. And it just went crazy huge because of his art. And I was kind of like, oh, I maybe should have taken that job. Because that Campbell kid, he's pretty good. He might have a future.
Hello.
On Friday, I was telling about my...
Nice shirt, dude. Okay. Turn around, show everybody your shirt.
Okay, Friday I was talking to her, told you that Marvel vs. DC was one of my favorite comics from you. And I told you about my favorite comics. So I would like to know your favorite panel or your favorite movement from that entire series.
A little louder.
I would like to know about your favorite movement from the Marvel vs. DC, the series.
When the royalty check came.
Your favorite panel?
That whole job was just more fun than I should have been allowed to have. My only regret with that job is that, you know, we had 4 issues instead of 44 issues. I would have loved to do the whole thing in as many issues as possible. I liked so many of the moments that we could do in that. So I don't know that I have a specific favorite. You know, honestly, I probably enjoyed the Doctor Strange Fate amalgam book that came out of that even more than Marvel vs. DC, because I got to work with Jose Luis Garcia Lopez, who was one of the best artists that have ever come into comics, and have it inked by Kevin Nolan, also one of the best artists that has ever worked in comics. So that's probably my favorite thing ever. The whole experience of Marvel vs. DC was just a joy, and you know, shockingly, for a project that should have been an editorial nightmare, because we had to get so much approved by so many different editors, it was really pretty smooth sailing. The editors were kind of told to you know, be very hands off with the stuff, because they didn't want to get bogged down in office politics and all that. So I don't know that I have a favorite moment, although I'm really, really kind of happy with Lobo and Wolverine fighting below the bar, and then one of them reaches up and grabs a cigar. That was actually back when you could smoke cigars in comics. You can't do that anymore. But that we did that scene because we had to have 2 different endings for all of the 5 main fights ready and drawn, because when that book came out, there was voting for who should win. So it was like a 900 number or something like that. You had to call in and vote who should win. And, you know, we knew kind of who was going to win for most of them. You figure that Batman's going to beat the Hulk, and or Superman's going to beat the Hulk, and Batman's going to beat Captain America, just because they're iconic characters. But So we had separate endings prepared for every eventuality, but we really didn't know who was going to be, Wolverine versus Lobo, because that was back when Wolverine didn't have 14 titles every month. So that gag we came up with so that we only had to sub out one panel and show somebody's hand reaching up grabbing the cigar.
Has there ever been any controversy while working with these two giants in the comic book industry, like Marvel and DC? Controversy while working on both the side of Marvel and the side of DC?
You mean like working for Marvel and DC at the same time?
Yeah.
It used to be fairly common, and it used to be the kind of thing that artists and writers did regularly, because you would play one publisher against the other to get a better page rate or to get treated better, and that still happens. But now it's more common for Marvel or DC to lock up people on exclusive contracts to... One, prevent, the talent from going across the street, and also to lock up people that they want to have fully involved in the universe and know what sort of plans are coming. Marvel doesn't want to have somebody writing one of their main books that knows, all about the future plans that are going to be made, like the Secret Wars announcement that Marvel just made at New York Comic Con. They don't want to have somebody involved in that that's also working at DC, because, loose lips sink ships. They don't want secrets getting out. So it used to be more common. Now it's less common. But ultimately, if you act professionally and the publishers act professionally, it shouldn't be a problem. More questions? We're done. Who's the next section?
So let me just wrap up this awesome session we had with you. For those of you who want to, have a little discussion or a signing, you can always go up to the booth. Ron's going to be there till evening. Today is the last day. But here's to a great stay in India. I mean, whatever days you are. When are you leaving, bro?
Leaving Monday night.
Monday night. So let's just say that, have a good Sunday night and a Monday before you leave. And India's going to miss you.
Thanks. I will miss India. You guys have to bring me back again, because this was kind of the experience of a lifetime. Seriously, thank you for all of the affection and all of the attention at the show. This has really been one of the best shows I've ever been at in my life. We got more posters. I'll be over there for another hour or so. Thank you all so much for being here.
Hyderabad, let's give a big round of applause for Ron Marz! And thank you so much, Abhijeet Keeney. Be sure to check Ron Marz. He's still available at the International Guest Hall. Excuse me, I have to put this away.